Shaskin Pub is open 7 days a week from 11:30 a.m. to 1 a.m. and offers the best food and drinks in downtown Manchester.
This hour on WMNH is proudly sponsored by CGI Business Solutions, located at 171 Londonderry Turnpike in Hooksett. Serving all your employee benefits planning, design and administration, investment and wealth management, and customized business insurance solutions. They are available at 866-841-4600 or on the web at cgibusinesssolutions.com.
You are listening to WMNHLP, Manchester's radio, Hertz frequency modulation from the top of 1000 Elm Street. Our studios are located at 1045 Elm Street and licensed to Manchester Public Television Service in Manchester, New Hampshire, USA. Contact us by email at wmnh953@gmail.com or through our website at wmnhradio.org.
Hey everybody, welcome. It's that time again. Happy Monday. Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. We are live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from glorious downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. Streaming worldwide at WMNHradio.org. You can also find WMNH on the TuneIn app, so you can take us wherever you go. Of course, we are on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page as well, right now as we speak. And of course, well, you know what? We skipped the big intro that we usually do, the countdown and all that, because we have a bunch of guests here in the studio, and I'm very excited because it's one of those things where it kind of feels like fate, because I ran into them literally on the street. And I and they got my attention, certainly without actually saying anything. They got my attention. So we're going to introduce them in a moment. Hello already to I see Ben Dion in the Facebook live chat, as well as Chris Rose. That is one way, of course, you can participate in today's show in the Facebook live chat, of course, on the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. You can also tweet me anytime at Matt Connerton, and you can call 603-250-6007, 603-250-6007. And we're joined by members of the organization Bloodstained Men and Their Friends. And let's start with you, sir, and kind of go around the room. And while everybody who's on a mic can introduce themselves, and everyone who's not on a mic can be introduced by someone who is on a mic, or you can handle the duties, however you want to do it.
Well, thank you for having us on the show today, Matt. And yes, it is an interesting stroke of fate.
Yeah.
that we met you on the street. But I am Brother K. That is my legal name, my Facebook name. I changed my name in 1986 because of circumcision, founded the Bloodstained Men in 2012, and we're here in your studio today in 2018.
Yes. Okay. Well, very good, Brother K. All right. You, sir.
My name is David Atkinson. I grew up in New York, and I live in Boston, and I am the CEO and co-director of Bloodstained Men and Their Friends, and I plan these protest tours that we do around the country.
Okay. And you?
My name is Harry Gearmond. I grew up in California. I live currently in Kapaa, Hawaii.
Okay.
I'm the on-the-road press spokesman for the Bloodstained Men and Friends.
All right. And you over here?
My name is Christina Love. I'm from Buffalo, New York. This is my second tour that I've joined the Bloodstained Men for. Last year was in Florida in February.
Okay. Very good. And yeah, lean into that mic there.
Hi, I'm Cynthia Maloney. This is my second tour with the Bloodstained Men and Their Friends. I'm from Boston, Massachusetts, and I just joined them 3 days ago, so I'm a little bit behind. But
okay. And I know it's awkward you're holding that, but if you want to lean in, you can introduce yourself. There you go.
My name is Brett Johnson, and I've been touring with the Bloodstained Men for a year now. And I met them when they came to my hometown in Kansas City.
Okay. Very good. Very good. So we should obviously, you know, with something like this, and this will be a very, you know, open discussion. I like to keep it loose. So anyone who wants to chime in, you know, don't wait to be called on. Just chime in.
Well, let me just
please. Yeah.
Let me just add right now, we've all introduced ourselves. I don't believe we've mentioned the word circumcision yet. We are a national touring group. We protest in 60 American cities a year. educating the public about the damage and harm of infant circumcision in the United States.
Yeah, and it is, you know, I mean, obviously, you know, there's going to be people who are going to snicker or whatever. That's natural, and I'm sure you run into that. But it is a serious issue. I had commented to – I forget who I was talking to out on the street, but, I'd made a comment that I'm very thankful that my parents said no to that, and I proceed through life gloriously unmutilated. There does seem to have been, though, I get the impression – tell me if I'm wrong, because I don't know any stats about this. This is just an impression I have – that over the decades, this has become much less common. Obviously, it still goes on at hospitals across the United States, but it's my impression is that there's been a movement against this, because a lot of folks will say it's not medically advantageous at all. There's no point to it medically. It doesn't, that it's all a myth, that it's helpful and beneficial in any way, so why do it? And then it really is mutilation if there's no purpose.
That's true. And actually, the federal Medicaid program allows states to opt out of paying for circumcision because it is not a medical necessity.
Yeah.
So there are currently 17 or 18 states in the United States that refuse to fund Medicaid circumcision of infants. And there are people in our movement that are working to get the other states to defund it. Our press spokesman, Harry Gierman, probably has some comments about the actual decline of circumcision in the United States, which is happening and ongoing and real. But, Harry, why don't you elaborate a little bit?
The best statistics we have right now is that about half, perhaps a little more than half, of the boys born in American hospitals are circumcised in the first year of life.
Wow, no kidding. Okay, yeah. So it's still a lot more than I necessarily would have thought.
Right, so okay. It's about 3,000 a day is the best numbers we have.
Okay. By the way, so welcome to Alderman Bill Berry, who joins us in the Facebook Live chat. And you're all getting some love in here. Lynn Shepard in the Facebook Live chat says, as an RN, I am ecstatic to see these brave heroes standing up for the rights of defenseless baby boys. Equality begins at birth. Boys are not born defective. You can also visit, and there's a website here, yourwholebaby.org, for more info. So very interesting. And Fred Bonig from thedailyripple.org also joins us in there. So you said it's about half?
That's what we hear. According to the CDC last said 56%, but that was a few years ago.
Okay. All right. Now, obviously, too, and to you know, this is an obvious question. I'm sure you run into a lot. I mean, there are religious, you know, if you're born into the Jewish faith, for example, that's obviously part of the deal and whatnot. I mean, you're not. I assume. Well, let me ask it this way: How do you address that? Because I'm sure there's people who come to you with that concern. Well,
that's an excellent question, and we have many Jewish men and women and Jewish families in our movement, and a number of the leaders of our movement are Jewish.
Yeah.
Rebecca Wald in Florida has actually put together a book with another Jewish mom in California, Lisa Braver-Moss, and they have actually put together a book of prayers for an alternative naming ceremony for Jewish families called Celebrating Brit Shalom, a Brit of Peace. So there are a growing number of, and there is actually a movement like what we're doing here in Israel, in Tel Aviv.
Really?
There's a bloodstained man in Tel Aviv, Israel, and people join him in protesting circumcision on the streets of Israel. They are a growing movement. The Israeli intactivists, so we're very proud to be their friends, and they have made a lot of progress over the years. It's an uphill struggle for them, but they are making progress. What we say is the same thing that Israeli intactivists say, that parents, it doesn't matter what your beliefs or religion is. And this holds for female circumcision, and the federal law recognizes that. There is a federal law that protects American girls mm-hmm. from female circumcision. And one of the regulations in that law is that your religion is no defense. The beliefs of the parent are not a defense. So this is a law that should apply to a male circumcision. This is what's happening in Iceland right now. They're trying to make their protecting children from genital mutilation gender neutral. In other words, girls need to be protected from genital mutilation. Boys needed and to be protected. Intersex children need to be protected. All children should be protected from genital mutilation. And your religious rights end at the body of your child. You do not have the right to mark a child with a sign of religion. If they adopt that religion and as adults want to undergo that kind of surgical alteration of their bodies, that would be their choice as an adult.
Yeah. You mentioned, so there is someone in Israel who's a part of your organization?
He wears the bloodstain. His name is Alon Sivrani. If you're on Facebook, you can find him on Facebook. His first name is Alon, A-L-O-N, Sivrani, S-I-V-R-O-N-I. And he's a veteran of Israeli armed forces, and he goes out in the streets and protests, and we share his photos. He shares our photos, and we have a lot of friends and followers in Israel, and it's mutual back and forth between us. We work closely with Israeli activists.
What about in other countries too? Do you have any presence in other countries? Because obviously there are places in the world where you mentioned female mutilation, where that's something that's very common. And I know there's a lot of good activism out there against that, fighting against that. But do you get involved in that at all?
There are a lot of UK intactivists in England and Ireland and Scotland. Australia has a strong intactivist movement. Australia had the same circumcision problem about 50 years ago that America currently has, and the Australian circumcision rate is now down to 10% or less.
Wow.
So they have wiped out circumcision in Australia in the last 20, 30, 40 years. And the same thing happened in the United Kingdom. Around the mid-1900s, a lot of English boys were circumcised, but then the National Health Service refused to pay for circumcisions, and it quickly died away. And now a very small minority of basically just Jewish and Muslim children are circumcised in the UK.
Lisa Perfect in the Facebook live chat says, thank you for giving airtime to this. Circumcision is a serious human rights violation. We have got to put a stop to cutting babies in America. The bloodstained men and their friends are heroes. And it looks like she put a link to your Facebook page in there, too, so you can get right to that if you want to check out the page and like the page and whatnot. Carl Silverman said something in the Facebook live chat that I'm not going to read out loud. and actually, it's a well-meaning comment. I'm just not going to read that out loud. But thank you, Carl. So are you all always traveling together? Are there other members of the organization that sometimes join you, or how does this whole thing work?
So because it's all volunteer, it depends on who's available to take the time to do one of these tours. This one's 3 weeks, 21 days long. So
okay,
not everybody can always volunteer for these things. So we assemble a group based on who's available, and we try to get 4 to as many as 8 in our group, and then go out on the road.
Okay. And then so when you're in a city like Manchester, or do you just come for the day and then spend a few hours? Because yeah. you were on Elm Street earlier, right? Holding yeah. signs or whatnot, or walking around. What do you do? Do you walk around and just talk to people and engage?
Yeah,
or?
Typically we spend 5 hours at a location. We usually start at 10 and end at 3. And we try to engage the public, either people in their car, motorists or pedestrians. If we're lucky, we get to talk to pedestrians.
Yeah.
And we hold our signs to make in the most visible place we can find in a particular in each particular city.
So the engagement that happens, is it people coming up to you for the most part? Because I would imagine a lot of people approach you because it's not like you have to make your presence known by, yelling out chants or slogans or anything. Like it's like, I saw you all, and it was, right away I noticed. you know what I mean?
Yeah, generally people come up to us. If they drive by and roll down their windows and want to engage, we just talk to them while they're in their car.
Yeah.
Whatever is possible given the situation.
Yeah. And then do you walk around or do you stay in one place for a while? Or
we sometimes go around the intersection holding a big sign and yeah. watching together, or just depends on what. Sometimes the intersections aren't conducive to that kind of activity, or the local police don't like that kind of activity. So then, in those cases, we just stay on particular corners.
Yeah.
But like today, for example, we were down on that far corner, and we walked about 10 minutes up the street to the Performing Arts Center here on Elm Street, and then we went down the other side of the street back to our location.
Oh, Peter White from The Morning Show with Peter White and the Moose joins us in the Facebook live chat, as well as Carolyn Clark Huff, who gives everybody a big thumbs up. So anybody give you a hard time here in Manchester, either police or just people who don't agree or don't like the presentation? Or
the police were great. In most places we go, the police are, you know, we work well with the police. They were great with us here in Manchester. They, you know, they explained just what the limits are and what we're supposed to do in terms of staying within the law and not blocking sidewalks was the key issue here. And so we always tell each other what's the essential thing not to do, and then we just do our best not to create any unnecessary problems for the police.
Yeah, and what about the engagement with the citizenry?
Oh, it's been very mixed. You know, we get a lot of thumbs up. We get sometimes upturned middle fingers. We get
do you?
You know, and then sometimes people get into shouting matches with us.
Really?
Yeah. It just happens.
It's bound to. Hello to Jeff Scumpy Lorenz, who is very often on the morning show. He joins us in the Facebook live chat and says, hi, guys. Carolyn Clark Huff in the Facebook live says, Bloodstained Men and their friends speaking out the truth. Over 100 healthy babies die every year due to a circumcision gone really wrong. That's over 1,000 males dying a year needlessly. Really? Is that an accurate stat as far as you all know? Because it's not something you hear about in the media. You know, nobody talks about this.
I think 1,000 a year is higher than I'd heard before.
Yeah.
I double check what she wrote. I think she wrote a figure.
Yeah, she wrote a thousand. Well, she said over 100 healthy babies die every year due to a circumcision gone really wrong. That's over 1,000 males dying a year. Oh, okay. So maybe it's 100. It was meant to be 100 when she wrote 1,000. Gotcha.
That figure, no one really knows. We don't really know. We do know that babies die. We document them several times a year on Facebook, but it's very hard. We can only document a death on Facebook if the parent posts about it or if a friend posts about it, and we've documented several of those deaths over the last few years. What commonly happens is that when a child dies of circumcision-related injuries and infections, it is not listed as a circumcision death on the death certificate.
That's what I was just thinking.
The circumcision industry has every incentive and motivation to conceal circumcision deaths. We know they happen. That has been established. There's a new article coming out in the next few months. A doctor from Cleveland put together his team, and they have documented that at least what was the figure on that, Harry? Did you see that study?
Oh, I'm blanking on the number.
No one really knows the number. We do know that there are more than a handful of babies die, and one authority does estimate that over 100 babies die a year. I'm reluctant to stand behind that because it's very, very hard to prove, but one authority has documented it and received a lot of agreement from others that it is at least or about 100 babies die a year because of circumcision. That is, if they had not been circumcised, they would not have died. There are babies who suffer heart attacks during circumcision.
Wow.
There are babies who bleed to death immediately after circumcision.
Yeah.
There are babies who stop breathing during circumcision. We see that on Facebook all the time where they had to resuscitate the baby. We never see the follow-up.
Right,
And I try to follow some of those, but those parents become aware that the intactivist community, and I'll explain intactivist in a moment, that our community of people trying to stop circumcision in the United States, when parents become aware that we have seen what has happened to their child, they often will shut down their Facebook page or make it friends only or even more than that. But people in our movement are called intactivists, and it's a coined term from two words, intact.
Oh.
When men are not a normal man with normal genitals is not uncircumcised. He's not un-anything. He's normal.
Right.
So
it's true.
We call that intact.
Yeah.
A normal man is intact. That is, he is not circumcised. And we are intactivists from adding the word activist to intact. So we're called intactivists.
Okay.
And we are working hard to reach the American public with the truth about this brutal religious sacrifice, because that's what it is. And that's why I changed my name, because even though they circumcised me in a hospital, I didn't buy it. I didn't buy the baloney. I didn't buy the medical cover story. I was not circumcised for my benefit. I was circumcised because it's an ancient religious sacrifice, and that's why American men have been sacrificed, have been circumcised.
And it's certainly not something you chose.
No, and men around the world do not choose circumcision. The rest of the world is intact, except for American men and the men of the Middle East, of the Middle Eastern religions, and a few African tribes. The rest of the world is intact. Europe is intact. South America is intact. Asian men are intact. Japan, China, India, they're all intact.
You're getting a lot of love in the Facebook live chat. Carolyn Clark Huff, by the way, clarified her comment. She said she meant 1,000 per decade.
And that probably is true. We just can't prove it.
Right, right.
One thing we do know is that when circumcision was dropped in the U.K., a study was done, and they found between 16 and 17 boys in the U.K. were dying from circumcision per year.
Okay.
And if you scale that up to the size of America, you end up with about 100, between 100 and 200. And because of these 16 to 17 boys dying from circumcision, circumcision was defunded from the National Health Service, and that's when circumcision ended in the U.K.
Okay.
And the only ethical thing to do in America is the same thing. So if boys are dying from unnecessary surgery, mm-hmm. that unnecessary surgery needs to stop ASAP.
Shana Boyson in the Facebook live chat says, "My heroes, you're amazing." Let's see. Elizabeth Lovell posted a link to an article. Mm-hmm. In there, which I'm sure has some information. So that's in the Facebook live chat if anyone wants to check that out. Thank you, Elizabeth. Trinette Jolyn Borgen, piggybacking on what you were saying, she says, "I'm undecapitated." Dave Branch wrote, "Proud to be part of today's education protest. New Hampshire is still so far behind the times and not understanding that this is rare in the rest of the world and that they are appalled. To learn we still sell this unnecessary medical procedure. Most nurses will tell you it is painful, brutal mutilation done without an anesthetic." And we have a call. We will grab this. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's on the line?
This is your old pal, Fred.
Fred Bonig from thedailyripple.org. How are you, sir? Welcome.
Good. An interesting conversation you have going on there today.
Thank you.
When I started in radio, I started as a gospel DJ, and the interesting part about that was I used to bring in pastors from all types of religions and ask them questions and debate them on the air, and I brought in a rabbi once, and this was the most incredible answer that I ever got on any of the major questions I asked. I asked him, I said, "Sir, why do you think God would choose circumcision as the sign of the covenant?"
Mm.
And he explained to me, he said, "Well, since Abraham's seed was the most, basically the most precious thing, it was going to create the entire the Hebrew religion there. It was going to be the chosen people. Where would you put the reminder that you had a deal with God about your seed?"
Interesting.
He said, "Would you put it on the back of your hand or your head or... where would you stick that reminder that this was sacred?"
Wow, that's fascinating.
I just point out.
I mean, and that to me was what that was. What I mean, and that was his answer.
Yeah, yeah.
But it makes a lot of sense when you think about you before you put that any place it's not supposed to be.
Right.
There is something that said that you have a deal with God that this is sacred.
Well, sir, doctors don't do religious surgery, so that's
no,
really
I understand
irrelevant.
I'm just saying that's
irrelevant
what it was
to
about.
The main thrust of our work, which is that American doctors are committing a sexual assault and injury upon our children, and whatever the reason that parents have, doctors, American doctors, should not be doing religious sacrificial surgery on babies' genitals.
Well,
all right, I'm with you. Just explaining how that was explained to me.
Yeah, yeah, because there's so much that goes on that that people use religion as kind of an excuse for, you know, not just this, but a lot of terrible things that go on in the world, war and, you know, many others. So,
but we're also talking almost 5,000 years. I mean, you know,
right.
4,000 years, something like that.
Right, right. Yeah.
You see, our founding.
2,000 since.
Our founding,
BC,
you talk 5,000 years.
That?
But 5,000 years, but. Our founding fathers were not circumcised. There was no history of circumcision in the United States when the American Revolution was fought, for example. George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, even Abraham Lincoln, all those founders and early heroes of the American Revolution were intact. They were not circumcised. There was no circumcision in Western civilization until the late 19th century, when American doctors introduced circumcision as a cure and punishment for adolescent boys caught masturbating.
That's interesting.
And this is documented in the medical literature, and there's a very popular video on YouTube called Adam Ruins Everything.
See, that didn't seem to work, did it?
Well, that's obviously the comment that a lot of people make.
Right.
But the intention is there. The intention of circumcision historically, and Maimonides, the Jewish sage, said that circumcision was meant to weaken male sexuality.
Wow.
So that's not a secret. That's not a secret.
And Leonard Glick, a Jewish scholar based here in New England, has pointed out in his book, Marked in Your Flesh, that most Jewish boys are circumcised in America without a ritual. They're circumcised in the hospital, just like their Gentile peers.
So oh, okay.
In most cases, I think he said 70% are not done with ritual.
Oh, that surprises me, actually. Wow.
And he further pointed out that there's actually been two covenants. In Genesis 15, there was a covenant which was kept with an animal sacrifice. And that's about 1,100 years older than Genesis 17, where genital mutilation was introduced into the religion. So if you use the argument from antiquity that says older is better, then you would go back to animal sacrifice.
Okay. All right. Fred, did
you... But you also keep in mind that if you were a person who was trying to keep the Jewish bloodline together, it would be a lot easier to spot one of your own, in a sense, than it would be if he just said, yeah, I'm Jewish. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
For that... You know, just that thought that was also, well, it was a mark, you know.
Well, yeah, you could tattoo a number on his arm, too. But, you know, that's not an ethical thing to do.
Or we could mark Jewish women, perhaps.
Well, just to be clear, I don't think Fred's arguing that that's an ethical thing to do. Right, Fred?
No, I'm just saying that might have been, you know, we're trying to find out. Also, I mean, believe me, if there's anybody in this world that understands that we need less religion and more, you know, free thinking in this world, it would be someone like me.
Right.
But all my point was is that, you know, for something to have lasted that long, there must have been obviously reasons in the belief that it was to keep the belief pure.
Well,
and
the
to,
only problem, sir, the
you
only
know, perpetuate its own self.
Sir, the only problem with trying to have a limited theory of genital mutilation like that is that it does not explain why people around the world who circumcise girls use many of the same justifications, including religious, as the people who circumcise baby boys. And so any theory of genital mutilation...
Oh, yeah, wait. But around the world, the one thing we have to understand is women were never on the same level as men throughout history in a sense of value. I mean, you know, so the reason why they circumcised women was hopefully to keep them from straying. The reason why they wore burkas was so other men wouldn't lust after them. It was all about keeping property. It wasn't about, I mean, no matter what your religion belief is, it was never about religion. It was about keeping property, and that's how.
Well, that's not what they say. That's not what they say. There are currently women in India who are lobbying to keep female circumcision alive, and they are now claiming that they will find health benefits for it.
Yeah. Well,
Hey, I'll let you guys go, but I'll keep listening.
Okay, thanks for the call, Fred. That was Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple. Let me just get the number in there again. That's 603-250-6007. 603-250-6007. By the way, this is John Hopwood. He's a frequent contributor on the show, just so you all know. And he's the one who texted me earlier, actually, that he saw you guys in town. He's also one of these people, though, who while I'm doing the show, he'll try to talk to me because people assume I'm really good at reading lips, and I actually can't read lips at all, so I have no idea what the hell you were trying to say.
What about the speakers?
What about them?
So people can hear.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Is he talking about India?
Okay. Anyway, so getting back to the show. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that would be okay with us if he wants to turn the speakers on, as long as it wouldn't interfere with your end of the show.
Well, it would interfere. That's why they're not on.
I see.
Because that would cause feedback.
But I think I just want to make the point that the main thrust of our work is not theological. The main thrust of our work is that American doctors have no right to be circumcising American babies in hospitals. There is no medical justification for circumcision, and we avoid theological arguments as much as necessary because those very often end up in a self-fulfilling loop of people justifying this with that, and it's fruitless. The no one can argue that circumcision removes part of the human genitals.
Right, right. Jess Atzma in the Facebook live chat is giving you guys some applause. Trinette Jolene Borgen says a sacrifice just one step up of total child sacrifice. Lynn Shepard says it's important to note that no medical organizations in the entire world recommends routine infant circumcision. It destroys thousands of fine touch nerve endings and many more functions. Jorkoop Connie says thank you for saving our boys and gives you a heart. Margaret Ellen Bradford says love you, Bloodstained Men Group. Thank you for doing this work and saving boys. Elizabeth Ropp joins us in the Facebook live chat. Trinette Jolene Borgen says, amen, preach it, Brother K. And kind of ironic she said that since you don't want to enter into theological discussions. But Sarah Olson is giving you some love. Morgan McPhee says, think about this. Most women leave the hospital in some type of pain after giving birth. Why would you want to inflict that on your new baby? If you know how hard it is healing in that area, how do you think a new baby would feel? It's just awful. I think we can all agree on that. Carolyn Clark Huff says, please invite the viewers watching from the Bloodstained Men and their friends' site to come to the WMNH live show site. Well, actually, they should come to the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page. And Paige Christine says, save our sons. Not only is – whoops, and then another – wow, getting a lot of love here. Not only is this saving our babies, it's setting men up for a healthy, pleasurable manhood as well. Melissa Lords Fernandez says, awesome. Everybody deserves the right to keep their whole healthy bodies. There is no other healthy body part that parents have the option to amputate immediately after birth for health prevention, family traditions, or religion. So you're getting a lot of support there in the from the listeners.
Hey, Matt, I only heard part of the discussion when I was in my car. We've talked about the issue before, but not in this depth, of course. But and it's an issue I know something about. And I just say that after 1945, my father once explained to me, and when he was in World War II, they had to circumcise some men that would come out of, like, the backwoods who had never seen running water or anything.
Yeah.
And that's one of the reason he thought that it became, in the post-World War II era, a major public service, public health, or whatever you call it, public health.
Right.
Hygiene was a big word they used.
Yeah.
Although I guess that went because of Hitler, the way of, you know, you don't usually hear hygiene anymore. But
We hear it every day.
Oh, I bet you do, yeah.
He was opposed to it. But when I was born in 59, my brother in 58, it was here in New England, it was 95% of boys were circumcised. And I think that happened right up to like 1980 in New England. It wasn't as prevalent everywhere in America and among some cultures.
I was born in 72 and I escaped it.
Like Hispanics, I believe, don't really.
Yeah.
Aren't into it, but that's general, you know, making something general.
Yeah.
But I heard one of the spokespeople saying that it's a religious act. I would disagree with that because it's pretty much, I would say, an economic act. Because, like, the UK tried it out after World War, the only two countries that really did it, I think, with the United States, the UK, maybe Canada.
Oh, definitely, definitely. There's a financial incentive for definitely. Yeah. There's a financial incentive for doctors.
By 1950,
it's inherent essence. The essence of circumcision is an ancient religious sacrifice. But the corruption of American medicine is such that very often its motive in the mind of the doctors and nurses for pushing on parents is financial.
Well, I would say when there was an article in Time magazine about 1980 where it was $150 million a year industry. And it's was a relatively simple procedure and highly profitable. But you see, in the UK, by 1950, they generally dropped it because they couldn't see the benefits of it.
It's a simple procedure for the perpetrator, but not for the victim.
Right. I'm not.
Yeah.
Said.
I wouldn't have.
And I should point out that David Atkinson, who just said, David, repeat that for the people in back who didn't hear it. That's excellent. I've never heard you say that before.
It's a simple procedure for the perpetrator, but not for the victim.
No, of course not.
And this is David Atkinson. I should tell you that he is the co-director of the Bloodstained Men Project, and he plans all of our protest tours. So we are here in Manchester because of his decisions. He sat down and he mapped out our 21 city route from Delaware to Maine, and that is David Atkinson who does all this hard work.
Very good, very good.
And what was the prevalent way of circumcising boys, I don't know if it still is, in 4500 was called the cauterizing bell, which is, I'm sure, you were actually
like
one where they strapped the baby down. And
yeah,
it's
we
pretty
don't,
grim.
Yeah, it sounds like a torture device,
right,
which I guess it is in a sense, yeah.
Because when you said that, yeah.
Philip Kennedy in the Facebook live chat says, his body, his choice, and... V Savage says, Bloodstained Men are such an incredible group. I first saw them in 2012, had to get involved. Devin Elizabeth says, disturbing how profitable circumcision is. And Susie Charlie Chapter says, it's cosmetic surgery on babies. I want to actually dig in a little bit on that. And you had referred to this earlier, Brother K. Devin Elizabeth made the comment, disturbing how profitable circumcision is. I always make the argument that when you're talking about anything, because I talk about, and there's other political things. I know you don't want to get political, so I'll be a little bit vague and just say, there's a lot of things that we do that logically don't make sense, things that we do in our culture that don't make sense. And I always say, if something doesn't make any logical sense, the answer actually is very easy, follow the money. There's right. always a profit motive. Can you address that, or any of you address that a little bit about the profit motive behind circumcision and expand on that a little bit?
We believe it's a billion-dollar industry. We've heard multi-billion-dollar industry, but it's safe to say it's a billion-dollar industry with 3,000 a day. And there are complications which require more surgery. Sometimes boys are recircumcised because of complications.
Sometimes they're amputated.
And
there's
this problem called meatal stenosis where the opening of where the urine comes out would be too small because of circumcision, and then it has to be reopened. And the boy goes through terrible trauma again, repeated trauma.
Oh my God!
And this is all for money. This is unnecessary surgery based on fraudulent claims.
Yeah.
Jeez,
that's
and
awful.
These boys are just helpless victims.
Yeah. Yeah. No doubt. Anthony Cold in the Facebook live chat says, please give the YouTube video An Elephant in the Hospital a shout out. It's a great intactivism video. What is that? Can anyone explain what that video is?
David Atkinson?
Sure. That's a university lecture by Ryan McAllister. I believe it's a Georgetown University. And he speaks for about a half hour about the functions of the foreskin and the history of genital cutting. And it's just a very good introduction to this issue for people who don't know much about it.
Okay. All right. Very good.
Well, one of the reasons given going back to the 1880s was going to stop male masturbation, which, you know, like I said, I grew up in a generation that was 95% circumcised. And it didn't stop anybody that I know of doing
right.
that.
It just makes it more difficult because you don't have your natural lubrication or your retractable moving parts.
And then for the intact guys, they don't have to use lube because things just move naturally.
That's
for
true.
For the cut guys, they have to use lube, and then that's just
Not just masturbation either, in the act of coitus, right. too.
Amanda,
it's a natural.
Amanda Press, by the way, made a comment in the Facebook live chat. I'm not going to read that one on the air, but it's a well-meaning point that she's making. And hello to Heidi Hamer, who joins us in the Facebook live chat.
Shout out to Heidi. She's the one who saw them at the protest.
Oh, okay, so she's Bridge the one who told you, and then you texted me. Yeah,
we didn't know. Remember, she was going to call in, but I didn't know the guys and gals.
Well, then
I
ran into them on the street as I was coming in. I ran into them, and of course, you know, it's hard not to notice.
I might suggest that since we touched upon the destructive effect of circumcision on the male genitals, that we hear from one of the women or hear from both of the women briefly if they want to talk about the effect on female sexuality because of this injury to men, to their partners.
Sure.
Well, this is Christina here. So cutting male genitals in heterosexual relations and even otherwise, I suppose it applies for all intercourse. It's been known to produce dryness and irritation during intercourse.
For the woman.
Mm-hmm. It can cause tearing, of course. Mm. This can also happen to the man. I've definitely experienced that personally. And we were actually just learning as we were watching another Intactivist 2-hour presentation that apparently there are some numbers. I can't recall what they are, but it's like women are less likely to experience vaginal orgasm
right.
from intercourse with a cut man than if she was with an intact partner.
Yeah.
And there's definitely been a lot of work around the sexual implications and effects of genital mutilation on males done by O'Hara. Blanking on the first name.
Kristen
O'Hara. So a lot of times when women have experienced both intact and cut men, they generally tend to prefer intact men. But then there's that very difficult area when it comes to dating, in that when you know more about this subject and you know that the vast majority of men who are survivors of this did not choose it for themselves, when it comes to dating and having a preference of who you want your mate to be, intact or cut, it can be extremely heartbreaking knowing what that cut male went through as a baby without his consent, but then basically rejecting him. That's the best way I can
say
to choose an intact partner.
Yeah.
So that is part of my struggle.
Well, yeah, it's not like, you know, it's not like it's something people put on their Facebook page. So it's not something you you know in advance. But I want to know. I don't want to go too much further down that road, to be honest with you, just because they're this time of day and there might be youngins listening. But we do have a call, so we'll grab this call. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's on the line? You can give a fake name because I won't know the difference. So be my guest. Give a fake name. Make it creative.
Hi, Hillary. Hillary.
Hillary. That's not that creative. Can you do a little better? That's all right. Go ahead, Hillary.
Hi. I was just listening to the live broadcast while I was watching it on Facebook. And somebody was discussing the difference between a cut male and an intact male.
Mm-hmm.
And I've recently been with someone who it looks like his circumcision was never complete.
Mm.
So there's still something there, though he has been circumcised.
Okay.
And there is a difference.
Well, a baby's penis is very tiny, and when these doctors are cutting parts off, there's a wide variety of different levels of damage that they do. Sometimes they leave some behind, and then sometimes you go to a pediatric urologist and they say, oh, well, we need to remove more, and generally that's not a good idea either, but it's definitely possible. You never know exactly how much of the penis the child is going to escape from the hospital with.
Right. I have been with men who is very, I don't know if you want to call it like tight or like stretched out almost, and my current partner not. It's like the opposite. And never having been with fully intact male, just this, I can tell the difference.
More is better.
Male. All right. Well, Hillary. we're getting a little too love line, but thank you for the call. Take care.
Okay, thank you.
All right, bye-bye. Bye.
And in terms of being cut too tight, I mean, all cutting is damaging, but when they
right.
cut them too tight, they can have painful erections or curved penises. And if you want to talk about an injustice, to condemn somebody for life to painful sex, the most intimate thing you could do with a partner, and to condemn him to that for life for no reason is just the most monstrous act you can think of.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can you all talk to me about like media, like some of the other, like I said, I mean, I ran into you on the street. This was completely spontaneous, but I think you had mentioned you've been on Howard Stern. Like, what was that like?
Not Howard Stern himself, but the network.
Sirius, you were on Sirius.
Sirius.
Oh,
the Sirius network. We were on the Sam Roberts show in Manhattan.
In
the same studios that Howard Stern operates out of.
Right. Right. Okay. What was that like? Was that because that's a big audience? That's satellite radio.
Yes, it was quite a powerful experience, and we got a good fair hearing from Sam Roberts, and he got some interesting calls. One uneducated nurse called up, and she was making ignorant statements about the necessity of circumcision, and by the time we talked to her, she was sobbing on the air, and just telling Sam Roberts that we were just wrong about everything, but she was crying.
She was actually crying?
Yeah, she sobbed, yeah.
Well, we challenged her with the question, describe the function and structure of the amputated body part.
Right,
and
right.
Of course, she had no idea because so many American medical professionals never learned this.
Yeah.
And so she didn't have... There were several seconds of silence in the studio, and then...
Right.
that's when she started crying.
Yeah.
John, hold that thought because we have another call. Okay. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this?
This is Daniel Rold. I'm an Intactivist.
Oh, hey, and, welcome. What's your name again, sir?
My name is Daniel Rold, R-O-L-D.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, welcome.
Yeah. I just want to mention that it's sad that men who have had this done to them can't stand up for their own rights. You know, we have had half the surface area of our penis removed and 75% of the nerves, causing lifelong damage and sexual reduction of our experience. And these men in America, they don't know the basic anatomy and structure of their own penis.
Yeah, they don't think
fact,
about it.
Most medical professionals and scientists have no clue about the fundamental anatomy and physiology of the natural male penis,
mm-hmm.
which is ludicrous. And it's an indictment into our medical system that is making money off of and profit from a cultural blood ritual.
Well, that's like what we were saying earlier, follow the money. You know, when something doesn't make
exactly.
sense, there's usually a profit motive, and this is just another example
exactly.
of it. Absolutely, yeah.
But it's just almost enraging that, you know, for all the men in the world, and none of how many of us actually know the actual anatomy of our genitalia? How many men on the planet? And I would say even in intact societies, very few of them know. I had I was having a conversation with a Swedish heart doctor who had no idea about the natural structure and function of his own penis. And this is a physician
right.
who's working on people's hearts. And this is supposedly a person that's been educated for years and years and years, yet has no idea of the structure and function of his own genitals.
Right.
And this is an intact man who can reach down and feel that half the surface area of his penis actually does have sensation.
Right.
And all this ridiculous, these ridiculous supposed science that we have that shows that there's no difference in sensation, that's literally ludicrous. It would be like saying that if you jab a pencil in one eye that you haven't reduced eyesight just because you can see the A on the opposite side of the wall.
Right.
That's crazy.
Right, right.
I mean, it's just ludicrous. And for them to say that, and yet you have 80% of the world that are intact, it can reach down and verify that that is in fact a lie.
Right.
It's a ridiculous lie, you know, and
yeah.
I mean, I just noticed that I'm a 42-year-old man. My sensitivity is reduced. It's harder for me to have an orgasm. It's harder for me to reach an orgasm.
All right. We're going to let you go because we're getting a little too love line again for this time of day. But thank you for the call. All right. Yeah, I don't need to know all those details. But all right. So now what's next? Like after you all leave here today, what are you off to next? Do you have another city you're going to? Or
yes, we should talk to David Atkinson about that. He's the master planner of these protests.
And we're driving into Maine as soon as we leave this studio.
Yeah.
And then we're staying in a hotel there. Sometimes we stay with our local Intactivist colleagues if they can host us, but we didn't find such a place for this upcoming night. And then we will be protesting tomorrow in Auburn, Maine, and then the next day in Bangor.
Okay.
And then we'll come back down through Dover, New Hampshire, and Boston, and the Cape, and Newport, Rhode Island, and Connecticut. And we finish this tour in Philadelphia.
Oh, okay. Very good.
21 days total.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Today was day 11, so we have 10 more days.
Now, is it always 21 days, these tours that you do, or do they vary depending on
this schedules? Is our longest tour. This is longest tour yet. Mm-hmm.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes. Our previous longest, I believe, was 19 days in Florida last year.
Yeah. We've been working up over the years to longer and longer tours. When I started about 4 years ago, we were just doing maybe a week at a time.
Yeah.
But we've gotten more disciplined and more able to create longer tours.
So, right, right.
Yeah. And David Atkinson is currently planning our next tour, which will be in late October and early November. It will be about 20 days from Texas to Florida and back to Texas.
Okay. All right.
That includes the American Academy of Pediatrics Convention protests in Orlando at their annual convention in the first weekend of November. And we protest them because they have this ridiculous statement that made in 2012, which claims that the benefits of penis mutilation outweigh the risks, but it doesn't include in its risks the risk of destruction of the foreskin, which is of course 100%. It doesn't consider amputating part of the body harmful at all.
But what struck me about what you just said is that that's as recent as 2012.
Well,
that surprises me actually.
Matt,
maybe it shouldn't.
For the generation that got circumcised after World War II, particularly in the late 50s, 60s, the medical reason was to prevent cancer of the penis. You didn't find, you know, this stuff was talked about very openly when I lived in the Bay Area in San Francisco because for whatever reason, the gay community talked about these issues openly in San Francisco, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You don't have the hang-ups that you have like in Boston, you know, where people would start talking about their, you know, male member, which, you know, I came out of New England and, you know, the reticence. Which, when you were talking about doctors don't know about things, and there are even to mothers that are taking home, and parents, a father that has been circumcised is taking home an infant that hasn't been. The doctors aren't even telling the parents about how to take care of a child with a prepuce intact, mm-hmm. a foreskin.
Or in many cases, they're giving them incorrect information.
Right.
They're telling them to forcibly retract this child's foreskin.
Well, that's what we did in the 60s.
So it's worse than nothing. They're actually causing harm. It's iatrogenic or doctor-caused harm, which is only done in this country, where they either themselves, when they go in for a well baby visit and they damage the baby's penis by forcibly retracting and then causing an infection, and then saying, oh, we have to circumcise him. So even if they didn't get them in
sense.
The first run,
I see.
They have this second chance to get them.
Oh, wow.
So it is beyond disgusting.
See, because my parents are born in the 20s, and that's the generation that's still the circumcised. So they got information from people that were born 18, you know, the 1800s and stuff. But that makes sense what you just said.
By the way, when did it start in this country? Because you were saying earlier, you know, you pointed out that when our forefathers came here, they weren't circumcised.
Well, back in 1880, there was some talk that I think, and then the guy who invented the graham cracker was, whose
right.
name is Graham.
Right.
Well, and there's a novel about him in a movie around 2000, but he was in, my father told me, he was born in 1926, he was told everything about masturbation, blindness, this, that, and the other thing. And he would never have thought about doing it, although, you know, it comes naturally, but the guilt trip. But, and Gore Vidal's written about it, and In California, it was done a little, but it wasn't prevalent till after World War II. And they used the fact that circumcising a male is better hygiene and there'll be less cancer of the penis, which I found out much later. It's an extremely rare disease. And that women would, this might sound familiar to this century, that women, the partners of uncircumcised men, the women had less incidence of cervical cancer. That was a big thing. It later,
I've heard
in 1980 and stuff, when people were starting to talk about it, like for the first time, pointed out that the study was based on people in Israel and India. And yeah, there was more cervical cancer in India than in Israel. But Israel was nearly, even in the 50s, nearly a first world country.
Correlation
and
is
India
not causation, yeah.
Is much worse than what you saw, like, you know, in Slumdog Millionaire.
Right.
So yeah,
of course.
Higher incidence of cervical cancer, but higher incidence of everything else.
Yes, but even if it was true that amputating part of a child's penis would prevent some disease in his future partners. That's just about the most despicable thing that I can even imagine, is to cut off part of a child's body because it might possibly benefit someone else in the future.
But that's the healthcare industry. We had somebody on, I think it was my show or your show when you had the TV show, that would not get her child vaccinated, remember?
Oh, yeah,
Jerry
this is the
Brown.
Whole anti-vaxxer movement.
But her
yeah.
point wasn't the simple ones like that we had. They wanted her to get her daughter vaccinated so she wouldn't get, like, genital herpes, because then she would have sex. And she didn't, you know. There's always a reason. And when it started falling out of favor again, suddenly not having a foreskin reduces the incidence of AIDS, which if you actually read, like, the statistics, it's so minuscule. And once again, we're dealing with Africa where you don't even – there's no health infrastructure in most
right.
of those
those
countries.
Studies were completely unethical.
They were
unethical
and
experiments
fraudulent.
On live human subjects.
They were fraudulent.
They were fraudulent, and they found 1% or less improvement, but then they sold it as 60% improvement.
Wow.
So it's just
much
completely
less.
Dishonest, completely unethical.
Well,
but
it was a simple solution to a problem.
The problem was how do we keep circumcision going, not how do we prevent HIV.
Right.
They never had any intention of preventing HIV.
She wanted to say something, I think.
May I just quickly address
yes.
what you asked about the history? So mentioned about punishing masturbation, and there's also some information in the literature of carbolic acid on girls. But when that fell out of favor because they realized boys would continue, then the next reasons, you can find quotes in the literature of, you know, supposed cure for bedwetting, epilepsy, blindness, spinal paralysis, sexual immorality, you name it, venereal disease, hygiene. Then the hygiene thing came online. So detectivists call it a supposed cure in search of whatever disease the people are most concerned about. So the lingering things are, you know, HIV, hygiene. Well, the father has, you know, this member, he should decide, or well, his father is, so he should be, or this type of thing. But regarding the HIV, condoms are the only things that will help.
Right.
No, there's something called Truvada, which you can take. It's a pre-exposure prophylaxis, which is called PrEP. And in the gay community, especially in San Francisco and other big cities, gay men take this. It's 98% effective in preventing HIV transmission. If you're HIV negative and you have unprotected sex, you're basically quite well protected from this. And if they really wanted to stop HIV in Africa, they would be distributing Truvada in high incidence areas.
I've read about this.
Instead, what they're doing is promoting fraudulently genital mutilation for these poor African men who are just victims of this deceit, and with no real intention of preventing HIV.
Yeah, yeah. Well, listen, we're getting to the top of the hour, and I know you all have some traveling to do and whatnot, but before we go, very important, I want to make sure everybody listening knows where to find more information, website, social media, whatever you want to mention, where you're headed next, so people know, because we have a lot of listeners locally, but we have a lot of people listening online from other parts of the country, too, so whatever you want us to know.
Well, Bloodstained Men and Their Friends is on Facebook. That's Bloodstained Men and Their Friends on Facebook. We have a website, bloodstainedmen.com or bloodstainedmen.org.
Okay.
Either one gets you to our website. And on our website, there are tabs that show upcoming events, There are tabs that have our, it's called a media tab, and it, you'll be interested to see that, Matt. It lists all the dozens and dozens of nationwide media that have covered our protests. And there's a tab called Resources. People can find links to a lot of the things we've been saying today, including doctors opposing circumcision, mm-hmm. Your Whole Baby, Bloodstained Men, Elephant in the Hospital. The when you go to bloodstainedmen.com, you will see at the top left of our page a statement that we consider so important. The 38 leading European physicians got together in 2013 and issued a joint condemnation of American doctors for circumcising our sons. And the link to that statement is prominent on bloodstainedmen.com at the top left of our page when you go on our page.
Okay.
And along with that, there is a link to the 16-plus functions that are lost when you amputate the foreskin of an infant.
Wow. Okay. Well, geez, this has been great. I mean, I've learned a lot.
Well, I just want to add that, you know, I can attest to it does promote immorality, but political immorality.
Yes, that's something different. Right. Well, this has been great. I want to thank you all. I'm so glad I ran into you outside.
Thank you, Matt. We appreciate it.
Thank
been,
you so much.
Our honor.
And I do want to extend the invitation. The next time you're in the area, if you do make it back to Manchester, New Hampshire, you're welcome anytime. So I hope that happens in the future.
Wonderful. Awesome. Thank you for having us on.
You got it. All right. Thank you. We're going to take a break. I'm going to play a song from a parody project called It's All Right Now. And then we'll be back with more Matt Connerton Unleashed. We're going to let these guys get out of here because they got a lot of traveling to do. Thank you all again. And I will be right back. More to come. Don't go away.
Took a little trip to Europe to pummel some old friends. Used threats and taunts on his EU jaunts. Then with Russia made amends. He kept the queen in waiting, then ignored her on a walk. But things went better at the castle. They had a lovely talk. And it's all right now. He's just a spoiled kid. You see, he can't accomplish anything, but he'll always say he did. We know he admires Putin, wants things with him to warn. How could he know that when they did, it would start a big storm? He's partial to the Russian mob. He likes their money, too. When that's the only thing you value, what's a guy to do? But it's all right now. All he has to do is lie, 'cause his worshippers believe in him, and they will until they die. La da da da. La da da. Predicted his own words, said we were not fairly paid by NATO countries we support, then he thanked them for their aid. He criticized the Brexit deal negotiated by Ms. May, then praised her for her leadership, and then ate her buffet. But it's alright now. It all worked out because even though he has no clue, he can just pretend he does. La da da da. La da da da. They called it the Surrender Summit. I think that's kind of harsh. But I guess that he deserves it, since he claimed that he could drain the marsh. He only wants to line his pockets before his time is done. What else would any grifter do? Why else would he have run? But it's all right now. November's almost here. He'll get
don't like what's happening, then voting made it clear. Da 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 da. All right now, there's no one else to blame. If you don't act, it'll just get worse, or it'll stay the same.
Welcome back, everybody. It's hour number two of Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon, live on WMNH 95.3 FM, emanating from downtown Manchester, New Hampshire. 603-250-6007 is the number to call. 603-250-6007. Of course, we're also streaming at WMNHradio.org. We're on Channel 97 Comcast in the Manchester area. Excuse me, I got to clear my throat there. And you can call us, 603-250-6007, or opine in the Facebook live chat. And speaking of which, before we move on from the last segment, I do just want to, for anyone still listening, I do just want to acknowledge, because I kind of, there was so much going on in the Facebook live chat, I kind of gave up on getting everybody's comments because we were getting near the end. But I do appreciate all the interaction. Anthony Cold, Kylie Buckley, who else? I'm just mentioning people who I didn't get a chance to mention before. Patricia Ruberg, Devin Elizabeth, John Chuck Gosson, who I see in there a lot. He chimes in on the morning show, too, quite a bit. I think he's in their chat room quite a bit. Dave Branch, and anybody that I forgot. So, just some folks who I don't think I was able to get to before. So, boy, they brought a lot of... a lot of attention to what I think was a pretty positive discussion. A couple of those calls I had to kind of limit there.
Yeah,
but that's not the fault of everybody here. But
well, it's the hour.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't get too technical. This is the United States. I don't think of it as just the last word. It's economic. It's you know, it's a health industry. I don't know if these. It's just like we call it when I was trained in communications, you know, by the Defense Intelligence Agency. You can create an echo chamber and feedback loops or something. You know, hey, it's profitable and.
Oh, absolutely. You know, like I always say, follow the money. You know?
But it's hard, for me, it's hard to believe that. I never thought that marijuana would ever get legalized just because of the puritanism of America.
Right.
But, you know, it just is incomprehensible, though, that this is still done late as this.
Yeah. And that as recently as 2012, that really surprised me, as recently as 2012.
Well, yeah, now they're saying it prevents the transmission of HIV. But I actually read that, and it's so minuscule to be, like, statistically insignificant.
That's, I mean, some of that stuff was stuff that was debunked, like, 2 decades ago, you know?
Oh, well,
like,
they just revive it.
Yeah, yeah.
But what the woman that called into our show, you know, it was the sheer number of vaccinations. You know, she did have her child vaccinated at the age of 14. Because Jerry Brown turned on all those granola-eating, you know, do-gooding liberals.
Yes.
And, but, you know, it's like, that, you know, and I would vaccinate my child. And we had that discussion. My brother was very careful. He got his vaccinations, the MMR, but he did them separately. Which Tony Blair, the prime minister at the time, you know, was a big proponent of it and said he had had his recent child with the MMR, and it turned out, no, he had done it. He did it not all at once. Because some research might indicate that it's the load, you know, you get. Well, I'm not anti-vax.
Right, of course, yeah, of course.
I believe that people should have a right to question things.
Yeah, oh,
even the
absolutely.
Holocaust, which is, I remember I was going to, I wanted to write a novel based on somebody like David Irving, the great, he started out as a very fine historian and then just went off his gourd, you know. And I just remember I was talking to my father about it. My father looks at me, said, John, never doubt that there was a Holocaust. They showed us the movies.
Right.
In World War II. And then Mac, my friend who passed last year, yeah, he passed around the time you moved on to here, and I did a little tribute the same night as your show went off the air. And he was there at a camp. He had to they transported women that were held in a camp outside of Berlin. Mm-hmm. And he said, I think I told you, they were like mannequins. It was almost like, he said it was horrible.
Yeah.
But the fact is, you know, to have a discussion about it, even with somebody like Irving, who, instead of getting, like, if you think of the truth, getting to the truth is starting out on one side of a chasm and you need a board to put down a plank that gets you all the way across.
Mm-hmm.
He's a guy that puts all these little planks, some of them are quite rotten, and then tries to get it across.
Yeah.
But when you do have these discussions with these people, I think it illuminates things. But of course, I was talking in a time before the recent climate where I still don't think there are many American Nazis. I was doing some research recently. I don't think that Trump has created this big burgeoning movement.
Right.
He's coarsened the discussion.
Right.
Because
yeah.
The way he has discussions is in a coarse way.
No, I think that's a very fair way of putting it.
I don't think that the people, there are more Nazis than there were. It's just now they've got the echo chamber.
They feel
boom,
emboldened
boom, boom, boom.
To be out in the open.
You know, I still am mad at the ACLU from when I was 16 and they defended Nazis that were going to march in Skokie, which is, I think, an affluent suburb of Chicago, that there was mostly Jewish and a lot of them were Holocaust survivors. Because it's, to me, what did William Kunstler, the famous radical attorney, said? Well, you know, the Nazis have their right, but that doesn't mean you have to take their case.
Right, exactly.
But, and then they didn't even have it. There was a very interesting movie made about that. I remember with Danny Kaye, who played one of the elderly Jews, about that. Because it's not a simple issue. But it was basically how those Nazis, these people, there were hardly any of them, and they create this huge media event by manipulating the system and the ACLU and everybody.
Oh, yeah.
But,
hello to Stefan Philbrook, who joins us in the Facebook live chat. I don't see Stefan in there that often. So, Stefan, it's good to see you in there.
I guess the segue from circumcision into Nazis into Trump was pretty deft, you know. Friends,
well, there is some Trump news, you know.
I haven't been following.
Of course
it.
There is. Trump.
What? No.
Trump has said he is willing to meet with Iranian leaders because, you know, he's following the same pattern he did with Kim Jong-un.
Does that mean you're going to be traveling again?
Yes, I hope so. Yeah, I can't wait to go to Tehran. He said he's willing to meet with Iranian leaders without preconditions amid heightened tensions between Washington and Tehran. Oh, Stefan in the Facebook live chat says, great episode. I'm surprised by some of the comments. I can't believe how many soon-to-be parents don't research this topic.
Do you know?
Yeah, that's a great point, Stefan.
I had two family members in Kosovo during the Yugoslavian wars, plus people I've known now, you know, that aren't. And that Muslims in Bosnia, they would use a artificial foreskin to get through roadblocks looking for Muslims. It was kind of like a condom that was, you know.
I've read about this, yeah.
And that's in Arthur Miller's play After the Fall, which is based, it's a Holocaust where they're transporting the French Jews. And I saw it when I was a kid. Why don't we put stuff like this on, you know, new productions instead of Downton Abbey and all that, the BBC crowd.
You mean Downton?
I always call it Downton. You know that.
I know.
And,
yes.
And
oh, we have a call. Maybe this is someone else calling.
That's
correct. You.
Well, I'll just say, and the thing, one of the Stacy Keach is playing the Nazi, and the guy gives this long speech, and he says, "Okay, Joe, just drop your pants." And it's like,
right.
But Arthur Miller, you know, was famous Jewish American, one of the great writers.
Yeah. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed in the Afternoon. Who's this? Nope, they gave up. They
drop
hung up.
Your pants.
Well, alrighty.
But
Stefan says in the Facebook live chat, such a barbaric practice. Like you said, follow the money. I wonder how many would opt for this if it wasn't covered by insurance. That's an interesting point. Yeah.
Well, I've heard that the British royal family practices circumcision, but they use a moyle, who's the ritual circumciser.
Nope, our caller is back. Hi, welcome to Matt Connerton Unleashed. Who's this?
Oh, hello, guys.
Eric Gagnon, how are you?
Yeah, I'm looking forward to being on your show tomorrow there, John.
Yeah, 1 o'clock, Mr. Baseball.
Oh,
yeah,
my.
Lenny's coming too, I guess.
I hope so. Maybe he can bring donuts, but we can't eat him in the studio.
Anyways, that was quite a lively discussion there on your show there earlier. Wow.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, it was very interesting and informative, and it was a nice surprise. I ran into them, and they didn't have to do anything to get my attention. Their uniform got my attention.
Did I tell you that part? That Heidi told me?
Yeah, I guess so. Why?
Yeah. What's that?
I know you guys are wrestling fans. It was quite a sad day in the wrestling world yesterday. Three wrestlers died.
Yeah.
Yep, Nikolai Volkoff passed away.
I never heard of this guy, though. Brickhouse Brown is 57. He had cancer.
Brickhouse Brown, yeah.
This one here was a shocker. Brian Christopher, he committed suicide. It was Jerry the King Lawler's son in jail.
Yes.
Why did he commit suicide?
He was only 46 years old.
He had a very serious substance abuse problem.
Oh, that's awful.
Sounds like he kind of threw in the towel.
Sorry to hear that. Rest in peace, all three wrestlers.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I always say when someone commits suicide, I don't know who they are, honestly. This guy here, Brian Christopher, but my friend of mine said years ago, he said it's a permanent solution for a temporary problem.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, even if it's not
as
so.
As you well know, suicide is a major problem in the United States of America, especially the veterans coming back from the war.
24 veterans, I think, commit suicide a day.
They
really?
Can't deal with reality, so they.
Not reality,
they,
but.
Take their life.
Well, reality in the sense of. Reality is socially defined, you know. You come from a war zone, which is a different reality
right,
altogether.
Too much death over there.
Oh, yeah. It's the brutality
there's
of that.
There's those guys protest on the on Elm Street. They say war is hell.
Yeah, they're, I'll tell you, you know, I listened to
they make a lot of money off it, don't they?
Who?
Hey, follow the money.
The government.
Yes, the military-industrial complex.
Oh, you mean the oil wars that we avoided for a generation because of the Vietnam vets like Colin Powell?
They say things happen in threes, so.
Things happen in threes. Well, we just had three
on the show tonight on wrestling show. I don't have cable anymore, but
right, it was three wrestlers.
Ring the bells 12 times for those.
Oh yeah.
For those fellas.
Yes.
Nikolai Volkov, the Hall of Famer.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
I remember he used to sing the Russian national anthem. He would sing the Russian national anthem, and then Hacksaw Jim Duggan would come out and hit him with a 2x4.
What's his real name? Like Joe Duggan or something? Oh, you said Joe Blaznalis or something?
Yeah. Oh, Volkov's real name?
We'll see you tomorrow.
Yep, right, see you.
Keep up the good work.
Yep. Thanks, Eric. I have a story about Nikolai Volkov.
But that's not his real name, is it?
No, I don't think
they
so.
They always are like, it's Bill O'Neill. They took on a persona, and then they become it. I was shocked to find Chief J. Strong wasn't even in the end.
When I was in high school, I worked at Sears, and there was this guy.
Is this going to be a real story?
No, this is true. This is a real, more of an anecdote.
No malice?
No, no malice at all, actually.
Well, he's dead. He can't sue you.
That's true. No, it's kind of a funny story. There was this older gentleman there, Mark Perry. He was twice my age, but when he was a kid, he and his friends were really into wrestling, and I guess Nikolai Volkov at the time, you know, the deal was, you know, he was a real Russian and he was a bad guy and he was evil and he only spoke Russian and he refused to learn English because he hated America and this and that. That was his persona. And then these guys are at like the Boston Garden. They got there like really early because, because they wanted to get autographs of the wrestlers going in. And I guess Nikolai Volkov, he's going into the arena and one of them yelled, hey, Nikolai, how you doing? And Nikolai just looks at him and he's just like, oh, pretty good. How are you? You know, it's just kind of funny.
Yeah, because if you look it up, it's your name's probably Perry Jones or something.
Yes.
But even if he wasn't, you know.
Fred posted a couple things about suicide in the Facebook live chat.
I'll never forget when I found out that Piotr Tchaikovsky, I always thought he'd been a halfback on the old Pittsburgh Steelers.
Huh?
Okay, that's a joke that went nowhere. That's a joke, actually, from the 60s.
Oh, well.
And you use the Green Bay Packers.
And I was born in 1972.
Jeez, oh, you probably don't remember the Steelers.
I've heard of the Steelers, the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Oh, what a team.
Fred's posting a bunch of, he's posted a bunch of things. He says people die by suicide. Committing suicide was a crime. Yeah. I mean, we're not. I don't really want to talk about.
Let's not talk about.
But there's there are helpful links from Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple in the Facebook live chat for anyone who's interested. And hello to your friend, well, and mine. I guess he's my friend too. Thomas Massengale joins us in the Facebook live chat.
There was a Canadian boy that was circumcised. I think he was one of twins, and they destroyed the end of his male member. I think it was the cauterizing bell. So they decided, at the time, he's born like in the early 60s, and it was one of those times yet again where, you know, there's nothing between XX and XY chromosomes, you know, a carbon-based, a biped carbon-based life form known as Homo sapiens sapiens. You know, nature versus nurture, that you could take a baby boy and raise it as a girl. So they raised the boy as a girl. And he kept going down to Maryland, where that's where they had the first and biggest and most thorough program about what's called now transgendered people. And there was a famous psychiatrist that had that thing. You know, we are what we are because your parents brought you up a certain way. Not because there's anything innate in you.
Yeah.
And, he hits adolescence. He never felt he was a girl, and lots of trouble starts. And he was constantly going down to see the psychiatrist. And finally, you know, he rebelled, and he became a male, but, you know, it was kind of too late. And he committed suicide. And when you were talking about the suicide and the circumcision, I remembered his case. I remember a book was written by John Colapinto, and he's no relation to Dave Colapinto, my friend. And it was just this book where just the misunderstandings and everything. Because first of all, he should never have been circumcised.
Right.
Then he was raised as a girl, but he was a boy, you know, he was. And maybe that's why that gives evidence to transgendered people, too, that case. Because he was going to be a boy.
Right.
No matter what.
Right.
And it was just a tragedy.
I don't think we're supposed to talk about, I don't think we're supposed to distinguish genders. I think it's un-PC.
Foreskins and suicide and wrestling, which brings us to Donald Trump, who embraces all those things. Because he either is or he isn't.
How dare you? He's a good Christian man.
I think in that statue.
Just ask the evangelicals.
Remember that nude statue they had, fiberglass statue down in New York?
Oh, yes.
He was predicted as intacto, I think.
Oh, my goodness.
I think
goodness.
The artist was British.
Oh, well.
We'll never know, hopefully, unless we ask if Melania calls in.
Well, here, I haven't heard this yet. So this is Trump talking about meeting with the Iranians. This will be exciting.
It comes in threes, the Iranians, the North Koreans, and who's the other axis of evil? We can make one up.
Well,
Colombia.
Wait, you said North. What about Putin?
Putin's not an axis of evil. They're good pals.
That's true. He's Trump's BFF.
Oh, Merkel.
Yes,
German.
That's true.
Oh, those krauts.
Here, let's take a listen to this.
Sorry to all Germans.
This is from a little while ago.
What you think Iran needs to do to reduce some of the tensions? And you've met with the leaders of North Korea and Russia. Are you prepared also? Are you willing to meet with President Rouhani? And under what conditions? And have there been any preliminary discussions about something like that?
I'll meet with anybody. I believe in meeting. The Prime Minister said it better than anybody can say it. Speaking to other people, especially when you're talking about potentials of war and death and famine and lots of other things, you meet. There's nothing wrong with meeting. We met, as you know, with Chairman Kim, and you haven't had a missile fired off in 9 months. We got our prisoners back. So many things have happened so positive.
We're in
but meeting with people, I had a great meeting, in my opinion. Of course, the fake news didn't cover it that way, but I had a great meeting with President Putin of Russia. I think it was a great meeting.
Great meeting.
In terms of the future.
It was huge.
In terms of safety and economic development and protecting Israel and protecting everybody. I thought it was a great meeting. Great meeting with NATO. I just explained NATO. Hundreds of billions of dollars more money will be paid into NATO, the coffers of NATO. And much already has. So I believe in meeting. I would certainly meet with Iran if they wanted to meet. I don't know that they're ready yet. They're having a hard time right now. But I ended the Iran deal. It was a ridiculous deal. I do believe that they will probably end up wanting to meet. And I'm ready to meet anytime they want to. And I don't do that from strength or from weakness. I think it's an appropriate thing to do. If we could work something out that's meaningful, not the waste of paper that the other deal was, I would certainly be willing to meet.
Do you have preconditions for that meeting?
No preconditions, no. They want to meet, I'll meet. Anytime they want. Anytime they want. It's good for the country, good for them, good for us, and good for the world. No preconditions. If they want to meet, I'll meet.
Okay. I don't have a problem with that. It's just it's shocking how inarticulate he is at times.
Is he imitating Alec Baldwin? Imitating him. Sounds like it, doesn't it?
It does seem like it sometimes, yeah.
It's like, I bet he got, you know, probably smoked a joint or something last night and still feeling a good buzz when he did that interview.
Will they be meeting for drinks? I guess not. Trump doesn't drink, right? So
he doesn't drink, and if you're an adherent of Islam, you're not supposed to drink either.
Maybe they'll meet for some cheese and crackers. That'd be nice. I'd want to be in on that.
You know, I was thinking when I was on the show with Jen and she was defending him about Korea, maybe she's got a point. Maybe he is getting some connections done to places.
I've defended him on that. I've given him credit on that, too.
And maybe he can do it with Iran. Iran is a much more democratic society than we take credit and be credited with. And I'm not saying democracy like, you know, Western European and North American. Ooh. There we go.
Somebody's...
it's summer.
Somebody's getting some testosterone out there.
Oh, yeah. You know, I saw some testosterone supplements over the counter. But, you know, in an unregulated world, who knows if it works?
Testosterone supplements?
Are you going to take testosterone supplements when you...
I could be suffering from low T, according to some ads I see.
You know, losing your perspicacity?
I don't know what that means, but it sounds like something I'll never lose.
It's wisdom.
And something I take for granted.
Yes, I was with I injected that into one of the Hillary Clinton speeches I wrote.
You wrote it. You were a speechwriter for Hillary Clinton?
Yes, but I can't tell you about the. I was only 14 years old.
Wow.
Yeah.
Jeez. Hmm.
I was swapped. One of those Yankee swap meets.
Okay. I'm very confused.
Mm.
According to Reuters, U.S. states are making a last-minute legal bid to halt 3D online guns. Are you excited about the 3D guns? You'll be able to get a 3D printer and make a gun? It's going to be very exciting.
Do.
I know, but soon it'll be like more widespread. We'll all have 3D guns.
The most liberal circuit of the Court of Appeals in the United States, the Ninth Circuit, has legitimated, to what degree I don't know, open carry. I expect a carnage of violence to sweep America. But, you know, that might not be a bad thing.
It's my favorite Slayer song, Carnage of Violence.
Yeah, yeah. A good title for a band, too.
Yes.
It's already taken.
I like the idea of a 3D gun. If someone's got a gun, I want to be able to see it coming right at me if it is.
What about, I've been in talks with Gene Simmons and Paul Stanley about an online, you know, service for a 3D plastic love gun.
Yes. Oh, my goodness.
But, you know, they're still squabbling the rights with Peter Chris.
We were talking about love guns earlier, but in a very different context.
I think it's Peter Chris's estate.
Oh, they don't have to. Believe me, they don't need Peter Chris's approval for anything.
Not even for love gun?
No, for nothing.
Ooh.
Paul Stanley and Gene Simmons can do whatever they want. They
like,
don't
like God. And Donald Trump.
Well, they are godlike.
Do you think Donald Trump is your favorite president?
Oh, absolutely.
I know he's
the most entertaining, certainly.
He certainly was our favorite subject when we had the TV shows back-to-back.
And he's made America great again. I mean, after 8 years of Sharia law and communism, it's so nice to be free.
Socialism, Matt. Socialism.
It's all the same thing. Anything with an ism is the same as any other ism.
Flatulism?
Yes, that's the same thing as socialism and communism. It's all the same thing.
I thought that was
thanks,
unique
Obama.
To our American Congress.
No.
Flatulism.
Tell you what.
If only we could harness the energy being released or stop it. I'm sure that, like, cow emissions, it's causing global warming.
Oh, the methane. It's methane, right?
How's Melania doing? We haven't heard from you. Oh, you haven't heard from her in a long time.
No. She hasn't called in a long time.
Is that because Jim O'Connell is taking a sabbatical?
Oh, maybe.
Where is Jim O'Connell?
I don't know. No one's found him yet. He's still missing.
Is he back in Ireland?
He didn't do a show last week.
Is he back on that mysterious island from which he came? And we're not talking about Ireland.
Right. The other island.
The one he admitted?
You know Dave...
It wasn't Fantasy Island, was it?
No.
He does look a little like Tattoo and has an accent. Although we don't want to get, you know... We don't want to... We've already broached the barriers of good taste. Now we're getting into bullying.
Yes. Dave Ridley hasn't called in a long time either.
You remember we were having some serious show and he just calls.
No, that's all right.
He never listens, though, to what's going on.
That's okay. We brought him into the... We just asked him if he had a question for our guests.
He also claims online that this is the premier showcase to talk about Manchester politics, which proves that he doesn't listen to the show.
That is true, yeah. That's a good point.
So what did you do this weekend, Matt?
Oh, nothing exciting.
Nothing?
Nothing exciting.
Do you ever make your own alcoholic beverages at home?
Yeah, I am a moonshiner, yes. Moonshiner, Ridge Runner. I drive down to Alabama.
Road.
Yeah.
Thunder Road.
Uncle Jesse and I make moonshine.
500-gallon tank, you know.
I drive around in a Dodge Charger. It's actually very exciting. I'm just not really supposed to talk about it on the air because it's illegal.
With that 500-gallon tank that starts right behind the, you know, the front seats and goes right, you know, down into the trunk. How do you fit in your Uber passengers? You just, like, strap them to the top of the vehicle? Like, you know, like... What was that Steinbeck novel? Tobacco Road.
Strap them wherever.
You do?
Oh, wow. There's actually a YouTube video of John Schneider and Tom Wopat performing Just the Good Old Boys.
Now, whatever happened to the movie... With what's-her-name Simpson or something?
Yeah, the Dukes of Hazzard movie?
Yeah, whatever happened to that?
Oh, it came out. It kind of bombed. No one cared.
Who played Daisy Dukes?
Yeah, Jessica Simpson.
What's ever happened to Jessica Simpson?
I don't know.
Singing
I think
career?
She gained a bunch of weight.
So?
Well, that can really hurt your career. I mean, I'm not saying it to be mean or sexist or anything. I'm just saying that can, if you're a female, that can really hurt your career.
Wasn't she a singer?
Yeah.
She doesn't have a reality show?
Well, that's long, dude. That's like 15 years ago.
And who was the Playmate of the Year? Anne Marie somebody who died and had a daughter, and they didn't know if it was the lawyer or the husband or something like that.
Anna Nicole Smith?
Yeah, yeah. Her daughter, I guess, is all grown up now. Maybe she'll be getting her own reality show.
I hope so. That'd be awesome.
Getting back to America's a reality show, do you know that there was a movie about 1979 and 1980, you can look it up, with John Ritter? It was called Americathon, where the United States was so broke that they have a marathon, a call-in telethon to raise money, which, you know, back in the 72, they had a telethon to raise money for the Democratic Party. And, you know, there'd be big stars there taking your, like, Rock Hudson and people taking your calls. Now, they weren't there long, but... That was what America was like in the 70s that Donald John Trump grew up in. You know, the secret government, a president that has to resign in disgrace, Sparrow Agnew, Jerry Brown, who couldn't chew gum and walk at the same time.
Why can't we do something like that now? Why can't we have an auction? Let's have an auction for America.
Why can't we just, to hell with, like, say, the penny and all that, and just have an American Bitcoin?
Ooh.
We could be issued them, and we could either get rich or not. Kind of like a metaphor for America itself.
Wow.
Except at my age, it's going to give me a lot better chance than I have now.
Well, maybe Trump can have a meeting about it. He loves a good meeting. He'll meet with anybody.
Would you meet with anybody?
I would meet with the Iranian leaders, but I'd want to bring like a bodyguard or something.
Would you bring somebody that could speak Farsi?
Yes.
Why? They can't speak God's language, English.
I would lower myself to accomplish something for the greater good. MAGA.
Do you know that in Iran, they believe that God speaks Arabic?
No. Oh, see, that upsets me. Everybody knows God speaks English. And by the way, he speaks it fluently.
Since the revolution in 1979... Arabic has increasingly infiltrated Farsi. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
So it's almost become a new dialect of Farsi. What do you think they teach at the Defense Language Institute?
What, I don't know what.
The Farsi of the higher classes, which was distinct from the Farsi that was spoken by the lower classes. That's what they still teach.
They should teach English. Isn't the Defense Language Institute part of America?
If they did, I would have passed.
Oh, all right.
But
were you held back? Were you held back a grade?
No, I got tossed out.
You got tossed? Why?
I flunked Russian.
Oh.
Everybody of my class that did pass wound up in a motor pool in Texas, and I wound up in a live Russian mission. You don't need much Russian to do what I was doing.
Right.
Well, you don't.
What were you doing?
We're not spying
exactly
on people in bordellos or, you know, in restaurants.
No.
What time is it?
Do you know something about the P-tape? Is that what you're hinting at?
I have nothing. Yeah, there's Naya.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All of a sudden, you know some Russian. Very interesting. I think Mr. Mueller is going to be paying you a visit. What time is it? It's 5:36 p.m.
Don't you think that the Mueller investigation and all that has just run out of steam and nobody gives a damn if they ever did, outside of a few people?
Well, we do have quite a few indictments and a handful of cooperating witnesses, so somebody sure cares.
Yeah, well,
Manafort's going to trial at the end of the month.
Maybe he'll get pardoned. Can you get you? Why not?
Cohen certainly isn't going to be pardoned. He's turned. He's the president's worst enemy now.
Oh, Donald Trump likes it that way. While he is doing his crying jag right now, and I'll leave it up to the audience whether it's Donald Trump or Cohen that's doing the crying jag. He's teasing him. Donald Trump is, if anything, is a tease. In a way, he's our first woman president, if you discount James Buchanan. And I don't want to, you know...
Where are you going with this?
Woman. He has these feminine wiles and instincts. I'm just... Now, you've got to give me a little, you know.
He transcends gender, is what you're saying?
I am. No. We're talking about gender as it was constructed in the 1950s.
Oh.
So, you know, this is not, you know, I was a Hillary Clinton supporter, like strong women. Hell, she, let her drop the bomb on any damn country she wants. But we're going back into the, in a 50s mode of thinking. Don't you think that Donald Trump, if you think about it, all the stereotypes of women in the 50s, he is like, he, you know who I would have, if I wouldn't use Alec Baldwin to play his character. I would have Greta Garbo, somebody like that. Or maybe Betty Davis.
Well, you'd have to dig them up, wouldn't you?
Well, we're talking, you know, time traveling, oh, which we know intimately.
Yes, well,
hopefully
of course.
We can get those U.S. Bitcoins back from the future that we, was the toll of coming back. I say that he has a 40s, 1940s, 50s, Betty Davis with grafting onto Greta Garbo and say, like, not a Harry, that type of persona.
Really?
He's, you know, it's a very, you know, I'll use the word feminine in certain, the femme fatale. Donald Trump is the first femme fatale president that we've had.
Well, if Bill Clinton can be the first black president, I guess Donald Trump can be the first femme fatale president.
Bill Clinton was the third black president.
Well, not according to Toni Morrison.
The first Negro president was Thomas Jefferson, because that's what they called him because of the Electoral College vote being weighted towards the southern states because African slaves were given, black slaves were three-fifths of a person for your Electoral College count.
Yeah.
And then William G. Harding was often accused of being biracial, which he told privately, says he didn't. He's from Ohio. He didn't give a damn. That's when the Republican Party was still the Republican Party.
So yeah.
Somebody could have jumped the fence, and what do I care?
Right.
And contrasting him with Woodrow Wilson, the Democrat who was a racist and helped revive racism in the 1890s with his History of the United States, which glorified the Confederacy, and when he became president in March 4th, 1913, he purged African American civil servants because you had in the 52 years between Abraham Lincoln and Woodrow Wilson, their first inaugurations, 48 years were Republicans who stood for African American rights. Teddy Roosevelt particularly. So he purged the civil servants.
Oh.
So they used to consider, I can't remember exactly why they called Warren G. Harding, because of his looks or something. They used to say Babe Ruth was biracial too, and then harass him. But he could care less.
Will you be discussing that on the baseball show?
No.
Oh, okay.
So that brings us to Bill Clinton was the third black president. Now we're getting to the first femme fatale president, unless you consider James Buchanan, who was it? One of the famous politicians of the time called him, and his vice president was a bachelor. They were both bachelors.
Oh.
The only bachelors. He called Miss Fancy and Aunt Nancy. Aunt Nancy and Miss Fancy.
Fred Bonig from the Daily Ripple says they recently did Harding DNA and he was not biracial.
Oh, really? Well, the funny thing, he just said he didn't care. What was it? Woodrow Wilson slapped the Eugene Debs, one of my childhood heroes, as well as Bernie Sanders, the great socialist union organizer, into jail for violating the 1917 Espionage Act for calling for un-Americans not to register for the draft. And that's one of the first things that Harding did was pardon him and then have him come to the White House. This is a Republican. Republicans were different back then.
Well, yes. By the way, thank you to Cynthia Maloney, who just gave this program a 5-star rating and says, Matt Connerton is wonderful.
Covington, yeah.
Connerton.
Matt Covington.
Covington. Is wonderful. He hosts and then I can't see the rest of the comment only because Facebook is being a little
show.
Facebook is being a little bit wonky, so I can't see the whole thing, but I'm sure I'll be able to see it later. But thank you so much, Cynthia Maloney.
Well, the issue then is, who was the first circumcised president?
I would agree with her, by the way.
That he was the first circumcised president?
Who? Warren G. Harding?
I don't know.
No, Fred said they did a test. He was uncut.
Would it still be intact?
Mm-hmm. That's how it works.
Where is he buried? In Ohio?
Yeah.
Wilson's buried in the Presbyterian Cathedral, which for some reason was the national cathedral. I don't think the United States should have a national cathedral. What do you think?
No, I don't think so.
I don't.
I think it's a bunch of crap.
I don't know how it became such a thing.
Sure.
Because wasn't our wonderful president the first femme fatale president that we know of? He technically was a Presbyterian because of his immigrant mother.
Who, Trump?
Yeah, she was a Presbyterian. He was a Presbyterian.
Well, yeah, that's what I've always heard him say. That's how he knows all about 2 Corinthians.
My paternal grandmother was a Presbyterian, but she converted.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, so she's a poser.
Well, she's dead.
Oh, she was a poser.
What was Uncle Ben before he became converted?
He made rice.
But why? It's Uncle Ben. Converted. Converted from what?
He converted things into rice.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Fred posted in the Facebook live chat an article that I can't actually click, but looks like it's about Warden Harding.
I say it's Bill Clinton.
And it's not my inability to click that has nothing to do with your post. It's just Facebook being wonky. Hello to Madison Reeves in the Facebook live chat, who says, great episode. Go, Brother Kai. Oh, that looks like it was from earlier, but it's just popping up on my end now.
I bet it was Bill Clinton, because when they were talking, remember in the one of the lawsuits or the Star report, there was some distinguishing thing about his
Yes.
And I thought, oh, he's probably being a redneck from Arkansas, which, you know, might as well be stuck about 1812.
Hey,
he's
nothing to get bent out of shape about.
They probably didn't have a ufologist over there, let alone circumscribers.
Ufologists?
Isn't that
like
the person that circumscribes you?
I thought that was like a studier of UFOs or something.
But then they were talking about the ufologist makes it so bend in time, you know, bending in time, string theory, all there's 19 right angles.
Well, they
so
say
maybe
a bend in time saves 9.
Maybe there were ufologists on there, and they got a hold of Bill and
right
gave him an angle.
Well, that's good for Bill.
And Bill, he was all about the angles.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. But he'd come back to himself as the better angels of his whatever self, as Abraham Lincoln would say.
Hey, if you're feeling a little bent out of shape, just grab a cigar.
Why would anybody?
That's what I say.
Why would any American president put that jackass, my 17th cousin, Winston Spencer Churchill, a bust of that jackass in the Oval Office?
Churchill? Why not?
Because he's an insufferable A-R-S-A.
But very quotable.
A fraud.
Very quotable.
A fraud.
A fraud. Now explain that. A fraud in what way?
This guy was a good propagandist, but he's utterly incompetent.
Mm.
When it came to when he was when he's head of the Admiralty in World War I, Gallipoli was a disaster. In World War II, he kept talking about, let's invade the Balkans and they will do Turkey. And it's like George Marshall, who's a World War I vet. We already went through Gallipoli, you idiot, which is a disaster.
You dummy, Churchill.
Jesus.
You didn't admire his admiralty, that's for sure.
FDR died, and he didn't get to write his history.
Nope.
His diaries and stuff, people are only going into them now.
Just now? Wow.
Well, some of them. I don't know why they were withheld.
Get on that, people.
But
if I had his diary, I'd be already halfway through it.
I had 2 famous cousins who are dead now.
Two
Princess
famous cousins.
Diana and that jackass. I'll take Princess Di.
Oh.
They're both Spencers.
Spencers?
Yeah. Churchill's Winston Spencer Churchill.
Now, the Spencer family, they started Spencer Gifts, correct?
How dare you?
What?
They were patricians. They're aristocrats because they're English.
Right.
FDR was a patrician.
But don't they also sell cheap T-shirts?
Just remember, an American is never an aristocrat.
And keychains?
They're a patrician. Uh-huh. You have to get your metaphors right.
Cup holders and stuff? No, that's not them. That's not the same Spencers?
Do you know, worldwide, until 1940, Winston Churchill wasn't even the most famous person named Winston Churchill. What state did the more famous Winston Churchill come from?
Ohio?
New Hampshire.
Oh.
He was a famous novelist.
How did I not know that? See, I didn't know this.
That's why he signed himself Winston S. Churchill.
Oh.
He was born Spencer-Churchill, but being a type of type A personality, and I'll leave it up to you what the A stands for.
Uh-huh.
He dropped Spencer so he'd be at the head of the line. Do they still have kids get in line according to the alphabet?
Why are you asking me?
I don't know. See, I was an H, so it never really did anything. Except in the Army, it was by height, so I always wound up dead last.
Oh, right.
Yeah, that was, yeah.
Well, at least you're not as short as Kim Jong-un. He's only 4'10".
That's not true.
Yes, it is. I met him. He wears lifts.
Why didn't you take me, then? I could have slapped him.
Well, I wouldn't want you slapped. What, are you trying to get us all killed?
Yeah.
Take you.
Hey, we know that it's not going to happen.
It turns out Dennis Rodman wears lifts. He's only 5'6". Who knew?
Do you know my father lived right next to Spud Webb?
Yeah? Did he wear lifts?
No, but he's 5'7", and he could dunk. He won a dunking contest.
Your father?
My father didn't win a... It was an NBA player, you idiot.
Your father was an NBA player?
No, Spud Webb.
How many kids did he have other than
you? You don't even know who Spud Webb is?
I've heard the name Spud
Webb. Do you know
Spud
Chandler?
I know he was a basketball player.
He was 5'7", and he could dunk a basketball and actually won a dunking championship.
Was he called Spud because he was short?
I don't know, but he lived next door to my father. And there's a funny story I can tell, but not all. It would have to be a Matt Connerton uncut.
Oh, my, yes.
I really can't tell that story.
Oh, my goodness.
My father and him got along pretty well.
Yeah? Well, good.
Except the... when the bushes separating the property, you know, started dying. But that's what the funny part of the story is about.
And you can't tell it on the air?
Not really.
Oh. Statute of limitations?
Spud's not still alive.
Is he?
I think so.
Hmm. Are you sure?
Yeah.
He's got to be pretty old, right?
You know, nowadays, a player of that, you know, a star in the NBA would not be living in my father's neighborhood because they'd make so much money.
Oh.
But then, you know, they did. They
right.
Would, the star, they were just like us. Carl Yastrzemski used to work in the off season. He only made $100,000 a year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, yeah. So you didn't get to talk much about Donald Trump.
No, I played the audio. He says he'll meet with the Iranians without preconditions. I say great.
I think that with the economy going gangbusters, I don't think your average voter is that disaffected with this guy, because it is the economy, stupid, as they told Bill Clinton, and Bill Clinton took that to heart. He really did.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And he did everything he could to keep everything in the bond market. He went a little too zealous at the end of his administration and got bamboozled, as he admits.
Well, because remember what happened to George H.W. Bush after the first Iraq War. He had a 90% approval rating.
And that's why there's no first-tier candidates.
And then the economy fell into the toilet, and so did his approval rating. Yep.
Bill was ready to run, but he thought he'd be like wind up as like Cuomo's vice president.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But Cuomo didn't run.
Yeah. I remember there was a lot of pressure on Cuomo to run.
It takes, in these days, it takes such a long ramp-up time to do a campaign. Even in 68, when Rockefeller tried to get in, he couldn't. It's too late after the New Hampshire primary.
I would say it takes a village.
It does. It takes. Nixon got the nod in 68 because he spent 4 years going to every Republican function and meeting every flunky there is.
Yeah.
Of course, in those times, most of the people that were delegates were selected by the party.
Yeah.
But that prepared him, and he won. You know, he won the nomination. He carefully prepared. It's like it was too late for Joe Biden to get in last time.
I really thought he was going to, because there were some clues.
Yeah, but he didn't have any money.
There were clues that he was about to get in.
Hillary, people that I know down inside the Beltway said that Hillary had already sewed up all the money that he could have had. His last chance was with UBS North America President Bob Wolf, who had sponsored the entire political career of Barry Obama, later Barack Obama.
Yes.
And he said, no, we're going with Hillary.
Maybe in 2020, Biden can be the fresh new face of the Democratic Party. It'll be great.
I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's... The Democratic Party seems like it's on the verge of collapse if you really think about it. All this propaganda that MSNBC and...
You don't think there's a blue wave coming?
CNN. Maybe in New Hampshire there might be. I don't see it happening in Michigan and places like that. Because Clinton had tariffs. People did that to keep the auto industry in various high-pay, you know, jobs that would keep a working person into, you know, like, the better part of the middle class.
Well, Trump's starting to back down, too, on the
tariffs. Well, he has to with the... with the opposition of the Republicans.
Yeah.
And then the Democrats are now the Whig party of Daniel Webster, because Democrats were for tariffs since Jackson got elected in 1828.
Mm-hmm.
Tariffs created the industry, and that's why you have the Civil War.
Well, from what I've been reading, though, economists are saying that, like, this giant GDP increase that we're having, it's just a giant bubble. It's a direct result of the tariffs, but it's a bubble, and it's going to burst, and it's going to GDP is going to plummet.
You mean those economists? They're all there's no Keynesian or any type of economics.
No, of course, there's
we're
many
all
different
Chicago school.
There's many different economic theories, but I haven't read too many economists who think what Trump is doing is a good idea.
Dude, you're reading stuff in a mainstream
to take it
press
to such an extreme.
It's all Milton Friedmanism. It's all Milton Friedman. Milton Friedman was against tariffs. Milton Friedman said there wouldn't have been a great international depression if the United States would have lowered its trade barriers and just absorbed all the goods from Europe and run up tremendous deficits, even though that was unprecedented and, you know, people were... You know, that was the philosophy. The Chicago School of Economics of Milton Friedman, which was... field-tested in Brazil under the military junta that came in with the coup of 64.
Junta's a great word.
Is now everybody. Gene Shaheen. They're all into it. This is like the end of the Soviet Union. There's only one reality being pumped out by these great mega companies that are part of conglomerates that all have fiduciary responsibility to their stockholders to maximize their profits. So they talk about these things like, oh, geez, the Russians. Oh, and all these, you know, what do you call it, the politics of identity. We used to call it wedge issues and stuff. I mean, it's ridiculous to, when you talk about economists, you're talking about such a narrow scope of discussion is allowed in the United States compared to other countries. You don't have somebody like Jeremy Corbyn, who is a real socialist, and the only person that says a word about him is Chris Herbert on his show, which is watched by 12 less people than the people that watch Ward 13.
Oh, my.
I didn't put that right, did I?
Junta sounds like a word that you can't say on the radio.
But you're talking
it?
About a social reality. You know, did these people predict the Great Recession of 2007? Because the Keynesians did. It said that this would happen.
By the way, thank you to Alana Guilford Gonzalez, who just gave the Matt Connerton Unleashed Facebook page a like and is enjoying the program, or program, as they say in some places.
Program is P-R-O-G-R-A-M-M-E in the UK. So we'll soon be saying it, too.
Oh, you think so? Why?
Well, it's so funny that after, you know, with the attack, Anglo-Saxon society just disintegrating to the only Protestant on the Supreme Court, where it used to be all plus... Like, they'd have one Jew and one token Jew and one token Catholic. The only Protestant is a former Catholic that kind of converted in, you know, is Episcopalianism really Protestantism? You know, these are things that we don't have the time to go into.
No, we're almost out of show.
But, you know, we have this incredible attack on the old culture, and then everybody loves Downton Abbey and all this British bilge.
Downton.
You know why? Because it's all about worshiping high-class people with money and class. Everything's about money. And America, which the only... When the people from the anti-circumcision group were talking about, well, this is a religious thing.
Bloodstained men and their friends?
You know what I'm thinking? Yeah, because the only religion in the United States is the almighty dollar. What do you think about that? I've run that flag up the flagpole. Let's see who's going to salute it, Matt.
Wow.
Probably I won't even get my normal 13 people.
That sounds provocative. Well, we are out of time. Do you want to plug your program?
No.
All right.
I don't want any more than the 13 viewers I have, which is 12 more than the Chris Herbert
show.
What
if one of them dies? Don't you need to have someone kind of in reserve?
No, we'll just go back to, we'll just go down to Ward 12.
Oh, okay. All right. Very good.
That's the west side, too.
All right. Well, we are out of time, so thank you. Thank you to, of course, the members of this great organization, Bloodstained Men and their friends, who came in earlier. Bloodstainedmen.org is the website, and, of course, you can get links to all their social media and so forth.
A Free Stater running for the Flotaria on the west side actually thinks she's running for Wards 11, 12, and 13.
For real?
Yeah.
Oh.
She, you know, Ward 13. There you go.
Oh. All right.
I'm not as delusional as everybody thinks.
Yes. All right, we're out of time. If you missed any part of today's show, it will be up in just a little bit at WMNHradio.org. Matt Connerton, Unleashed in the Afternoon, live weekdays 4 to 6 right here on WMNH 95.3 FM.
We have next week. I mean, tomorrow.
Oh, tomorrow. Who is it?
Congressional candidate Naomi Andrews.
Yes, she'll be joining us at 5 p.m.
Yeah.
Or 5P, as they say in the business.
1,700 hours, Matt.
Oh, wow. Getting all right. Very good. All right. So tune in for that. Talk at y'all a little bit later. Bye, everybody.